kind of a dramatic example, but that's the way it works.
Can I just ask a question? When you're in a relationship and things are being mirrored and you recognise that it's probably not about them, it's about you, and you deal with, you do your soul searching and you deal with your issues, which hopefully then don't get projected back at you, but then you can sometimes recognise them in somebody else, like someone will do a drama, this is mine, you know, like you're doing your abandonment drama, you can recognise what someone's doing. Does that still mean that you have subconscious hooks yourself still, or can you clear your own stuff out but still be aware of it around you?
Yeah, it all depends on your state of mind. I mean, if you feel a sense of peace as you're watching something, it can be the Holy Spirit just using it as a teaching device, pointing something out, noticing this, and then also maybe giving you even helpful instruction for something that you may be able to share or extend that will extend the blessing. So it really comes down to whether there's like a charge there.
That's what I've been using as a guide. If it doesn't upset me, I'm observing.
Yeah.
Doesn't mean I'm doing it or mirroring it or creating it. But if I'm getting antsy at all or uncomfortable, I assume there's still something hooked in there.
Yes.
I just was a little bit confused. If as long as I see it, does it mean I'm mirroring it?
Yeah, it's more that if there's a defense mechanism that you're aware of, if you have a charge on it, all it's doing is it's reflecting something that you still believe is possible. So that's why there's the charge, is because you still believe in it, and then you're seeing it and identifying it, and there's a charge on it. But when you reach a point where you have no charge on it, there's no identification with it. And in that sense, you're freed.
Stop
borrowing
that body.
Yeah.
Move on to the next one.
Yeah, you don't have to try to say, well, I'm still seeing it. I think, too, there is a place where you merge into this purpose, where for me it was, you become so into the purpose and so into this sense of unified purpose that even the seeing of it, the perceiving of it, disappears. Because perception is selective, you know, what we perceive, you know, is what we believe, and then when your mind becomes so unified, you, in one sense, that's what I mean by the Magoo mind, you can become oblivious. There could seem to be a hurricane going on around you, but you're in such a still point that you don't identify it. And yet the Holy Spirit can still offer that which is helpful. You know, you could still, if somebody asked for some help or whatever, you would be able to address it. So, like for example, telepathy, there comes a phase where you start to be able to be very telepathic and pick up lots of thoughts. But then the more you get into your purpose, then it's like, even with that, you don't take any of it personally. You're not reacting or responding at all to any of it. And that's where the joy is very consistent. So it's more like a state of detachment than it is of, you're not really ignoring anything or trying to avoid anything. It's just that you become so detached from those ego thoughts that there's no interpretation going on of anything, of events or circumstances. And that's very, or you could say another way of saying that is it's a very peaceful interpretation of what's going on, the Holy Spirit's interpretation. So it's quite calm.
On that note, say a big one this decade, September 11th, could you maybe explain how you would perceive that event through the eyes of Christ? Maybe to a child who doesn't understand?
Yeah, I mean, it's, without the belief in attack, you know, as you get farther back in the mind, it's actually the world is kind of like swirling leaves or swirling feathers. You know, to the Holy Spirit, there's no interpretations of things, because only through attack thoughts does the perception of a world come in where specifics can attack other specifics. And So, you know, you could look at the event, you know, it's just like with the fall of the Tower of Babel, you know, in ancient days, you know, this was like a symbol of Wall Street and money and building things. You know, this world is, you know, a bunch of paper tigers, or you might say that it's like a house of cards is another way to describe the world. You know, it can be built up, like you can build a house of cards. You know, you have to carefully set them together, but you can see from the wind blowing the trees outside that just this amount of wind would blow over a house of cards. It wouldn't take much. And that the world is symbolic of like a self-concept that's really very fragile and volatile. You know, everyone can get into prosperity and building more and having stronger nations and more prosperity and greater economic growth and bigger gross national products for the nations and more technology and so on and so forth. And yet it's still a house of cards. It's still very, very fragile. And so when things seem to collapse, whether it's economics, whether it's the World Trade Center or whatever, I think it's just good to watch your emotions, and it's also good to be reminded that this world is backwards and upside down. And that's why as you go more and more on the journey inward, you start to put all the focus on your state of mind and your interpretations, and you start to take it away from this idea that there are external events happening or that there are forces of evil in the world that are fighting against forces of good. You know, you hear enough political speeches, you know, where the leader of one country will say, God is with us, God is on our side, or something, and it just sounds funnier and funnier that this idea like God would take a side or is in favor of a particular people or a group of people or a nation. We do have this, we make it this movie that we were watching in Sydney, and people were laughing so hard because the movie was just pointing out all of the hypocrisies that there are in this world, in all the religions, and, you know, it's talking about God, but really not living it out, not really walking the talk, you know. And so, if you were talking to a child, you know, you might talk about, you might have to use the whole thing as more of like a metaphor, just like we have so many great parables that kind of like focus on, you know, what's the motive underneath instead of what's the outcome in form. I actually had a friend, and have a friend in the States who was very devoted to the Course of Miracles and has meditated for many years, and she was born on September 11th. So, on the morning of September 11th in 2001, she was having a birthday party with a group of her Course of Miracles friends. And they were partying, and somebody said, oh, heard something from somewhere, turn it on. And they actually turned on the TV screen and watched the scenes and the events, but the party continued. And you really have to know her to really, really know her deeply, to know her devotion to practicing the principles of the Course in Miracles, to see that she really wasn't in a state of denial. The party continued and didn't slow down. It might have been picked up a bit during that morning, during those events. It was because of a lot of years, over 20 years of mind training, of really allowing herself to be convinced by Jesus of the value of peace, and of that nothing in the world can give it to you, and nothing of